Hello, my name is Mark Volchek. I'm the founding partner of Las Olas Venture Capital. We're an early stage investor in B2B companies and based in Fort Lauderdale.
Awesome, Mark. Thanks so much for making time to join us on the IV podcast today. I'm excited about this conversation. I don't get a lot of opportunities to talk to fellow Broward, Fort Lauderdale-based partners, investors, and founders from that perspective. So that definitely adds another layer of excitement here. Before we talk about the Las Olas Ventures and things you're currently working on, tell us a little bit about your backgrounds, kind of the thumbnail version of your career path.
Sure. So I started my career as an entrepreneur. I started a fintech company back in 1999 as a senior in college, and was fortunate to raise 5 rounds of funding and ultimately take the company public in 2010. And then I stayed on running the company for a few years before I decided that it was time to move on and try something else. So we decided to take that company private. I left my full-time role in 2014, took some time off, stayed on the board until the company went private in 2016. And at that point, you know, I started the venture firm that I work at now with one of my colleagues from the company that, you know, we worked in. So we had worked together for 9 years during that period. And so I've known and worked with Dean, who is my, you know, co-founding partner for Las Olas Venture Capital for almost 20 years now, which is really an asset when you're starting a venture firm that, you know, it's not easy at the beginning, and having worked together is really important.
Oh, that's super exciting. And thanks for sharing that a little bit of a background. Sounds, you know, very similar. Also being the founder operator myself of many startups, most of which I failed. Luckily had some successes here and there. But that transition onto, you know, as an angel investor, really my motivation was to really take that kind of the path, all of the lessons learned throughout these, you know, multi-year journeys of building the companies and fundraising, and help those startup founders right now that are going through something similar. So share with us your thought process, your decision-making that really led you to start your own fund. Was that the aspiration, or is that something that happened organically? Just share with us that process that you went through.
Sure. So it was really organic. You know, Dean and I had been doing angel investing together since 2008. And after we had sort of exited, you know, our company, we were looking for sort of our next thing to do. And we considered sort of starting another company, but instead we really enjoyed the angel investing route. And we had started creating a series of LLCs and had co-invested with a number of other people. And so as we got immersed in sort of the South Florida ecosystem and started meeting some people from Atlanta, we really found that there was a lack of early stage capital that was professionally managed with full-time, you know, partners. And that sort of one thing led to another. And we decided to start Las Olas Venture Capital to fill that void and in some ways professionalize our angel investing. So, you know, the first money into the venture fund was our own, and then some friends and family. And then we found some local folks in Florida who were interested in investing in tech and were looking to, you know, co-invest essentially with us. And that meant investing in our fund and helping us build Las Olas Venture Capital. And that was really back in 2016 when we kicked off, you know, the fund. And, you know, originally our first close was only $10 million. We eventually expanded fund one to almost $30 million. And that's really what we've been investing kind of in 2016, 17, 18, and 19. And then last year, we kicked off the process for Las Olas Venture Capital Fund 2.
Well, that's super exciting. And what a journey. And it also, it resonates on so many levels that you basically treated that as another startup that you were launching, that you had to go through the fundraising route as well to raise for your fund, and starts with the friends and family, like just like in a typical startup. So share with us that experience. Obviously, you mentioned that you initially put your own money into the fund, which I guess was a huge validator for a lot of people that got involved. But not a lot of entrepreneurs who are looking to form their funds probably don't have that luxury to do that. What were some of the challenges that when you were going through the process really formulating and forming that fund of yours?
Yeah, so I mean, it certainly is a challenge, as you describe. You know, fundraising is always difficult. And we did treat the fund as a startup. I mean, we had to hire people, we had to find, you know, back-end administration. We had to figure out all the vendors to make the, you know, the fund work. And then fundraising, you're essentially selling a vision, a thesis. You're selling yourself, very much like founders. You know, investors invest in great founders, and ultimately, you know, limited partners invest in, you know, general partners that they think can make outsized returns and pick the right companies and build the right type of portfolio. So I do think it's very challenging to start a new fund without having sort of capital of your own to sort of put into the fund, to maybe make the first few investments, you know, on your own balance sheet that then will go into the fund. And additionally, you know, there's, it's really difficult to make, you know, the fees work to cover the expenses. So one of the things that's important is for us is that Dean and I are really taking very sub-market salaries for many years, similar to many founders who don't get paid market salaries while they're building their companies. And the more you can sort of take that and invest the management fees into hiring great people, into finding great companies, that makes a better fund. And so it's always a fine line between reinvesting into the fund and into deal flow and into all the different aspects of going to a fund. So I always tell people there's sort of two paths to sort of becoming a venture capitalist. One is sort of to do it yourself and start a fund from scratch. And that requires substantial sort of experience or substantial capital and personal sort of network capital. You know, a lot of the funds in fund one came from people that knew us or we knew for many years. And we had to really, you know, cash in sort of our human capital, all the people we knew to get that done. And so the other path is more traditional, is to join an existing venture fund as an entry-level person and get experience that way and kind of work your way up and then either, you know, become a partner in that fund or start your own fund after gaining experience at a venture fund for a number of years. And those are really the two paths in venture capital.
No, that's very interesting. And how did your experience as an angel investor really set you up for success as a venture capitalist? Because one of the reasons I'm so active and have been in angel investing is really to get to understand and almost formulate my own thesis, what works for me as an angel investor, because I am able to move a lot faster versus me joining a syndicate or joining another, you know, venture fund. So that's kind of the process of decision-making that I went through. What was some of the decisions that led you to, you mentioned you started as an angel investor and then progressed into VC?
Yeah, so I think it's having investment experience is really important. So for us, we really relied heavily on some of the things we learned through our angel investing, you know, for 8 years before we started the fund. And we made a lot of mistakes. I think early on, many people do angel investing as a form of sort of almost charity to the ecosystem. You sort of invest and give back to the ecosystem. After a few years, we started being more active in terms of taking board seats or advisor seats and helping the entrepreneurs. And we really enjoyed that. So it's important to know what kind of fund you want to run, where your strengths are, what you know. We only invest in things we know. So we focus on B2B because that's, we were entrepreneurs in the B2B space. And so we invest in things we understand, where we can be helpful, where we have meaningful contacts. And I think a lot of that came out of some of the experiences we had as angel investors. But it's never the same, right? Running a fund professionally full time, you know, is very different. And, you know, it's important to figure out what the thesis is. What can you do different? What's your differentiation? Very similar to a startup. You got to figure out what's your value add. Why are you the right person to run this fund? How are you going to source deals? How are you going to get into the best deals? So there's lots of different questions, similar to the questions we ask entrepreneurs. You know, why are you the right person to do this business? You know, why do you have some special expertise? What's your secret sauce? It's really, like you said earlier, it's a different form of startup, starting a fund from scratch. And the angel track record is important, not in the sense that it's really a measurable track record. We had made a lot of angel investments, not all sort of in real startups. We had done some funds and we had done a bunch of different types of investing, but we learned a lot through that. And some of our early investors did ask us about that angel investing and we gave them some of the examples. And if you can do it in a professional way where you can create sort of a track record actually numerically out of your angel investing, that's a good thing. But most people actually really can't do that. Just because of the way these things work and things take a long time and you don't have the information from all your companies. As an angel investor, you often don't have access to the same level of information that you would have as a professional investor in these companies.
Right, absolutely. And that resonates on so many levels. You've mentioned a little bit around evaluating founders. For me, that's where, you know, part of my investment framework, that's where it starts. And I like to follow kind of the digital breadcrumbs of the founders going back to their early days, high school, college days, where you know, did you join the club or did you form the club? Were you the cartographer or were you the navigator, so to say, and really trying to understand the kind of their personality from that standpoint. And some other things that as an angel investor, I probably, you know, I don't have the capacity to be able to make a smaller investment first and see how they operate. But I do things such as, you know, I make certain introductions for that particular founder and see how they operate, see how they run with that, see how they follow up and actually take advantage of that. Really, oh, you know, that can say a lot about how the founders operate. Tell us a little bit about your evaluation criteria. What are some of the early indicators in founders that you look for when you meet them?
Yeah. So, I mean, first off, I would say that obviously, you know, the founders are the most important thing. I mean, most plans we get are on paper a home run, right? You know, everybody has a vision to change the world and build a big company. So in the end, the only thing that really matters is, can this team, this founder, pull it off, right? Can they make it happen? It's all about execution. I mean, clearly we care about the idea and the problem and the solution, but ultimately, most of the things that people pitch us, you know, are great business plans if you can pull it off. And that's where our operator side really comes in. You know, being entrepreneurs at heart, we kind of, you know, put our mind as if we were in their shoes and say, okay, if I were this person, how would I do it? Is it feasible? And we try to evaluate the founder and see if we think they can do it. Very similar to we would interview, you know, maybe an executive at our company, right? We look at their backgrounds. We try to evaluate, are they really smart? Can they get it done? You know, what's their background been? What experience do they have? And most of our founders are not sort of the typical, you know, maybe Silicon Valley type founder that's 2-3 years out of school and came up with something similar to what I was. My business, I was, you know, in my early 20s when I started it as a senior in college. Most of our founders actually have, you know, real experience in a sector, and they've come up with some problem or some solution that's not obvious to the average person. Because it's very sector specific, it's a B2B type problem. And so we can look at what did they do in their career? What did they, you know, do to get to where they are today? And then very much like you said, our interaction with the founder is really important. You know, how quick do they respond? How thoughtful do they respond? You know, often after a first or second meeting, we'll send them follow-up questions that are very open-ended, maybe around competition. Maybe it's around their sales process, their go-to-market strategy. And really, you know, we are looking for the answer, but we're also looking for how they get to that answer and what do they resend us and how quick do they send that back to us? You know, if somebody sends us a very thoughtful, you know, well-developed answer the next day, that's great. If it takes a week and we get, you know, 2 sentences, you know, for each question, that's maybe not so great. And, you know, how do they interact with us? You know, the same way they interact with us is how they're going to interact with clients and customers and employees. And so we really take all of that into account, all the way to the term sheet. We've had, you know, multiple deals fall apart as we're negotiating the term sheet because the founder's just not reasonable or doesn't understand issues and, you know, can't actually negotiate different points because they don't understand them. To the point where I've literally suggested to founders, let's talk in 3 days, you know, why don't you brush up on all these terms and then we get back together? And some founders just can't do that. And so that's really important. It's almost, you know, I hate to say it's a test, but if you can't negotiate a term sheet, then you're going to have a really hard time negotiating customer contracts down the road. Right. I think those are all important to us, but turnaround is actually one of the things we found over the years that when founders are very slow to respond, that's usually bad news. And we really stay away from founders who, you know, in today's world, you know, 1 or 2 day turnaround on email is fine. You know, 1 or 2 weeks, if you're trying to raise money from me, is probably not okay.
100%. No, I love that. And that just part of the reason why I actually do that kind of very small test, so to say, is, yeah, I'm going to take the time and my own network and introduce you to somebody. But at the same time, I hope they help you. But at the same time, it's really an opportunity for me to evaluate how you actually, you know, operate from that perspective. So everything you've talked about, you know, resonates on so many levels. You've mentioned a little bit about interviewing and surrounding yourself with, you know, with just, you know, the best team all around. And for startups and the founders, one of the key criteria of success is also being able to recruit and build a high performing team. And from your standpoint as an investor, as you decide to join that particular founder as a value add service, as a value add provider, what are some of the things, or what are some of the recommendations that you provide to your portfolio companies when it comes to being able to recruit the best of the best in the industry? Because I understand, you know, the market is just crazy all around. There's war on retention, not even war for talent. But for startups, it becomes even harder because you don't have the brand name. You don't have probably the benefits that other companies can offer. What are some of the things that really help you help your startups?
Yeah, so you're 100% right that talent is really, really important, from the founders to the executive team. And I think the key there is to find people who have a joint vision, you know, give them equity stakes, give people options, have them buy into the company. You know, we want to compensate people fairly, but clearly equity is part of that compensation. And also just culture and vision and excitement and all those things are important. And I actually think with the pandemic and more of work from home and remote, some of those things are more difficult. There's less of a bond, less of a shared vision. And so that's one of the things that our companies are struggling with. And there's lots of strategies to deal with that. But that I think is the key, you know, as a startup, you know, clearly pitching, having good investors and getting people involved. And some people are just cut out to work for startups versus others like the big corporate environment. And so the key is to find the right executives and the right employees who want to work for your company, even if the benefits are maybe a little bit less or other things. But I do think even for startups, you know, there's ways and strategies to have great benefits, you know, using a PEO. You know, you can supplement a lot of the benefits, you know, having the equity pool. And as you grow, you know, making sure you're on top of it and making sure people feel rewarded and making sure people feel appreciated, all those things are really important. And so one of the advice we give companies is make sure you start thinking about HR and thinking about culture, not as sort of a administrative function, but as sort of a talent retention, talent recruiting function. Some of our companies have hired very early on, like an in-house recruiter that, you know, is part of the culture. Some companies, you know, the founder does it or the co-founder, depending on what the team looks like. And again, in today's virtual world, in some ways it's easier because you can recruit from anywhere, but at the same time, it's harder because other people are recruiting your folks away from anywhere. And so there's two sides to that coin. And I do think a lot of companies are thinking about what will the world look like when they go back to in-person, in-office type environment, and having hired people all over the world, it's really hard to go back to an office then. And how do you deal with that hybrid scenario, which I think many companies will end up in a hybrid scenario where there is a core team in the office, and then you have a bunch of other folks that may be part of the core team, but they're not physically in the same place. So that's gonna be challenging for many companies to come. And I think some companies will figure it out and others will struggle with that.
Those are great perspectives, and you've nailed it on the head that a lot of companies thinking that, oh, we're shifting to fully remote will provide us with this great access to candidates worldwide, but they overlook the aspect of there's companies probably a lot bigger, a lot stronger than, you know, a startup hunting the same talent with the same strategy. So there's always that balancing act. But what I've noticed with some of the more successful founders, that people that do join these startups, they don't necessarily join because of certain benefits or other things that you know, that are measurable. They really, one of the main reasons is they do believe into the vision that the founder is trying to build with, you know, with the services and the products that they're building. So it's founder's ability to really clearly articulate that and motivate people from that perspective. I also found that, you know, it's, you know, not every founder comes with that. So it's something that the skill that has to be continuously improved. When we talk about, when I first got into angel investing, one of the things that I didn't realize is kind of that the dark side of the industry, of the more challenging side of this industry, is that ability to say no 99% of the time. For me, that was very challenging. For me, that was very hard. It's something that I didn't expect, but that comes with the territory. Tell us, share with us your thoughts on some of the challenging or more I guess the not sexy part of the venture capital. What some of the things that you did not anticipate that you continuously have to overcome?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I fortunately, I think, had a good idea of what we were getting involved in just because we knew a lot of people in venture capital. We got a lot of advice before we started the firm. But some of the things people told us, which I think is very much true, is that fundraising is much more difficult than you expect. It's also, you have to find a lot more investors. I mean, we're always, you know, looking for investors, even if we're not actively fundraising, we're talking to people for the next fund and we're trying to build sort of a pipeline. And some people don't like fundraising. I personally do. I raised money for my startup for many years, and I actually like telling the story, and I sort of inherently like that aspect. It's the sales aspect, right? You're selling sort of the story, the vision, the thesis. But it's difficult because a venture fund, you don't have a product. We don't have patented technology. We essentially have the people and a thesis. And, you know, we do have some proprietary deal flow that we get through different sources of people we know, but those are all personal relationships. It's very intangible. Mm-hmm. So selling that story is difficult. So I'd say fundraising is much more difficult than most people expect. And then, you know, I think some people assume that it's this glamorous, you know, idea of being able to like come and fund these cool startups that just pop up from everywhere. But really it's sifting through, in our case, you know, over 1,000 companies every year to do maybe 3 or 4 investments. So, which means we say no to, you know, over 1,000 companies every year. And that's not easy because some of them are really cool and some are interesting and some, you know, maybe one of your investors referred one of these companies and really wants you to invest in it and you don't think it's a good fit. And so you have to say no. And so I do think saying no all the time is very difficult. But at the same time, when you do make investments and you work with the entrepreneurs, it's very rewarding because you see the progress, you see the growth in these companies and you see the difference you can make. I think the other aspect that's difficult that people underestimate is sort of as the companies grow and get subsequent rounds, working with those later stage investors collaboratively, not getting pushed out. I mean, how angels, as an angel investor, you know that once there's a professional investor in, you have very little input into the company. But we try to stay relevant at least through a few rounds. And because we have a strong operating background, often people want to keep us on the board as a counterweight to some of the financially oriented investors. Mm-hmm. And so in some ways we're fortunate that we stay on the board and we stay relevant, but at the same time, our influence does get diminished. Sometimes, you know, some of the later stage investors want to take away some of our rights in the documents and, you know, working through those things is not always fun and sometimes creates friction. But that's, you know, being in business and doing business, and you learn to deal with those things and build relationships with investors. Many of the investors we co-invest with over time, they invest in multiple of our companies and you get to know them and you find a way to have a working relationship.
Mm-hmm. Right. Absolutely. When it comes to the deal breakers, for me, it's aside from the traction, the revenue or the founder market fit or the product market fit, some of the things I pay attention to, I guess, from, you know, personal perspective, like a broken cap table is usually very, you know, good indicator for me that it's going to be very hard for me to get involved, even though I believe in the mission or the product and the founders. Some of the other terms that are part of the agreement, you know, the pro rata rights and things like that. What are some of the things that you pay attention to when you make an investment outside of the standard, like the revenue and the traction and things like that? What are some of the deal breakers for you?
Yeah. So, I mean, your example is a good one. I mean, cap table is sometimes a problem. It usually can be fixed if there's reasonable people around the table. And if we're writing a big enough check, sometimes that can be fixed. But we do want to make sure the founders have a reasonable stake after the seed round. So, you know, companies where there's a large sort of passive investor is an issue. And that could be some sort of co-founder who left, you know, is not with the company anymore, but still owns a big chunk of the company. We've seen some strange, you know, spin out type scenarios where some company that has really nothing to do with the startup, owns a big chunk of the company. So cap table issues, but I think those are pretty rare. I'd say, you know, very rare does that really become the obstacle. For us, it's really, you know, finding the right team and then finding an opportunity where there's a real solution for a real problem. And, you know, and geography is another one that I think it's important for founders to really figure out what the criteria is for a specific firm. So for us, we don't invest in West Coast startups. We really want startups, you know, in the eastern side of the US. So that's kind of Texas to Chicago and east of that. You know, it's important to know that, because if you're sort of, you know, spending a lot of effort to get in with a VC that doesn't invest in, you know, where you are or what you do. And so for us, we really screen that against traction, geography, you know, make sure it's B2B, right? So we get pitched all kinds of consumer products or medical devices, and we just don't invest in that. And that we try to make it very clear on our website. So I think to that point, you know, one of the early things we really pay attention to is how thoughtful the first reach out is. So if it really is a cold inbound or even an intro, if someone doesn't do the research on us and just sends us random things, or, you know, doesn't really line things up, or I really recommend not to use, you know, some kind of mass email software to approach VCs. You're much better off, you know, reaching out to 10 venture capitalists who are really the right ones than send 100 cold emails, because we react negatively when we get these mass emails that clearly were not specified for us and show that the founder didn't do any work and doesn't really know what we do. So I think that's really important and can really sour things. I mean, we get emails sometimes from folks that we already know that obviously we were just some mass email list, and that kind of, like, you know, leaves a sour taste. So we look at a lot of different things. And also the other thing to remember is that people have infinite memory today with their email system. So something somebody sent me a year ago, I can look up very easily. So if someone comes to me again and says, oh, we're now at, you know, $250,000 of ARR, I can look at their plan from last year and see where they were. And if they've made very little progress, you know, that's not good. So I caution folks to remember that anything you send to anybody these days can really be retrieved very easily and creates a permanent record, almost like a file in the old days of old business plans and old proposals. And that's, I think, really important.
Right. No, absolutely. What are some of the trends and ideas that you're personally very passionate about that you're researching on in your free time? What is the next big thing that's in front of you that you're very passionate about?
Yeah. So, you know, more recently, we've been really interested in companies that are sort of using AI, and simple AI. It doesn't have to be deep science or something, you know, revolutionary. It's really using basic AI to solve, you know, efficiency problems. So these are, you know, we look for B2B, you know, SaaS applications that really replace some administrative function or, you know, some manual process with essentially a vertical application that uses AI to really just make something more efficient. You know, there's lots of complicated things being developed and self-driving cars and all kinds of things. And those are big ideas to change the world. And we're a small fund, so we really don't, you know, play in that space. We look, you know, for applications that can really make a difference in a very discrete way and really apply AI in a predictable way, right? So it's clear that, you know, most recently we invested in a company that helps with, you know, certain workforce scheduling. And it's using AI to do that, using prior data, using it watches how you do it and then suggests it to you next time, you know, so you can save time. Those types of applications really get us excited, because similar to 20 years ago, people were going from sort of paper and sort of the internet revolution 1.0. Now there's sort of new tools like, you know, AI and even vertical applications. There's still lots of industries that use Excel for what they do. You know, in the old days there were clipboards. Now people use Excel, but there's still a much more efficient way to do some of those things. And that's where we think, you know, with reasonable capital and good execution, you can build a really big business in a lot of these verticals. And that's kind of what we're focused on.
Yeah, those are very interesting. Absolutely. When it comes to deal flow, I try to categorize things into different buckets, so to say, where this is an elite deal flow, this is a standard one, and this is kind of the one that's unfiltered, so to say. For those that are just entering the investing industry in general, what are some of the recommendations you have to build a quality deal flow that really can save a lot of time, save, you know, from that perspective? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so deal flow is really difficult because the key is to have quantity and quality. So the key is to look at lots of deals. We target, you know, 1,000, 1,500 opportunities a year. But then the question is the quality. How many of those go to a second call? How many go to a first call? You know, we track all the different stages and we really try to improve the quality, but also get quantity because quantity is important. And so it's very difficult to give a prescription for deal flow. I think that's one of the things that sort of is a hallmark for a successful venture capital firm is to get a good deal flow. And I think it's very difficult for an angel investor to do that because you have to look through lots of things. And we spend a lot of time reaching out to other investors for referrals. We work with angel groups. We stay very close to later stage investors who sometimes send us earlier stage deals. We do a lot of speaking. We go to a lot of events. So there's no one answer to that question. It's sort of a lot of different strategies, similar to, you know, a startup when you're trying to get leads to sell whatever software you're selling. There's lots of different strategies. You go to trade shows, you go to conferences, you do online marketing. We don't do all those. They're different strategies for VC, but there's no one answer. And if we look at where the sources were for our, you know, deals we did invest, they come from all over. We've done, you know, a few that have come cold inbound. Most are referrals from either professional service providers or from other investors or people who, you know, I met at one of these conferences. So it's all over the board. And I think that's one of the issues for angel investors. How do you get sort of the fast and quick look on the best companies and not get the leftover companies? And I think that's one of the challenges that if you're not in that deal flow and can't move as quickly, but like angel groups particularly are challenged by their speed sometimes, they end up with some of the leftover deals. And you really want to be careful about negative selection issues on deal flow, which is a problem as an angel investor.
Right. No, absolutely. I can agree more with you because, you know, there's a big difference between the deal flow and access. Everybody can build a deal flow, but having access is, you know, you got to have a specific strategy for that, whether you have a particular leverage or a certain expertise in certain areas where the founders and the team, they will be more lenient towards actually working with you when it comes to taking your investment. So I think there's all kinds of different strategies that could be deployed. Mark, from your perspective in terms of content diet, what do you utilize on a daily basis to, you know, self-educate for self-actualization? Share with us any sources that help you stay ahead of the game.
Yeah, so I mean, a lot of it is really just talking to folks. I don't read a lot of regular, you know, stuff. I mean, I do get a lot of newsletters from all kinds of sources and I skim through it. A lot of it is also just curated from my partners who sent me stuff and we share things on Slack. But it's very much, you know, also from the companies. So being on certain boards, we get some content from the companies, things they share, and a lot of business plans. You'd be surprised, or pitch decks, really. A lot of the education comes through actually meeting entrepreneurs and talking to them about their businesses. And that's really cutting edge. For me personally, it's hard to sort of read regular content and stay on top of it because often it's not real life. Talking to entrepreneurs who are in it and going to events and talking to people what they're doing is really how I personally like to get up to speed. But I think everybody has a different strategy for that. You know, my business partner, Dean, I think does a lot more reading. And then we share stuff, things I learn at talking to people. And so I think that's a very personalized approach, but it is important to stay ahead of it and know what's going on and stay close to it. And that's why I feel like being a venture capitalist, one of the great aspects is you're always talking to people who are on the cutting edge of their industry and are really leading the change, you know, building these great companies. And that's really, for me, the most exciting part in terms of learning is from the companies we invest in and from the companies that pitch us.
Yeah, that's super interesting. And I can, and, you know, it resonates on so many levels, because at the end of the day, you also get exposed to so much information, whether that's companies pitching you and, you know, your business partner sharing information. So it's just being extremely selective how you curate that particular content and get your mind exposed to. So that definitely makes sense, you know, everything that you've talking about. Mark, can't thank you enough for your time today. This was a very short and insightful conversation. I personally learned quite a bit. What I like to do with a lot of the guests is to actually do a follow-up episode in about a year or so and see how much have changed and transpired. And we can revisit our conversation a year ago and see, hey, here's some of the things we've covered. Does that still apply? Is that still the trend? So I'm definitely looking forward to doing that with you.
Great. Thanks for having me. Really enjoyed the conversation.